for coming, everyone. Merry Christmas. It's so great to see all of you guys here.
I love Christmas.
It's my favorite time of year. I love everything about it. I love the cold. I love the Christmas lights.
I love the materialism of the holiday. I love the greed.
I love the fact that everyone is miserable, but they have to pretend that they're happy. I love everything about it. My favorite thing about Christmas time is Christmas media. You know, like Christmas commercials, Christmas movies, The Grinch Who Stole Christmas, Charlie Brown Christmas. I love that every Christmas, every single television show has to do a Christmas episode, even if it doesn't fit with the tone of the show. So you turn on the TV and like, oh look, it's Christmas time on SVU. That's exactly how it is. I recently discovered a relatively new addition to the Christmas canon that I consider to be indispensable. It's Glenn Beck's Christmas novel. Glenn Beck, I'm sure you know, is that crazy asshole conservative pundit who used to have the Fox News show with all the chalkboards, and he had conspiracy theories, and he like really hates Woodrow Wilson. I don't know if you know. Woodrow Wilson way more than most people hate someone who lived 100 years ago. Woodrow Wilson passionately, personally. The amount that you hate a guy who ran over your dog. Like, Woodrow Wilson, fuck that guy! Don't even mention his name! Do I want to go to a barbecue? Is Woodrow Wilson going to be there? Of course not. Glenn Beck is differentiable from the other asshole conservative pundits like Bill O'Reilly, Sean Hannity, and Glenn Beck is really out of his mind. So the things that he says, they come from a place, you know, they're rooted in ignorance and intolerance and selfishness and a complete detachment from reality. He does not live in the same place that we all live. It's like he thinks he can walk in both worlds or some shit. And he has completed the transition from individual to corporation. Glenn Beck no longer is a man, he's an idea. He's just a name that exists in places and things are bought. He sells gold to you, he sells like reading apparatus, he sells patriotic memorabilia, he's got online classes. The man has written two novels. Two of them. The second of them is called The Overton Window. It's a political thriller, and I haven't read it. Yes! And the first of them is called The Christmas Sweater. That's why we're all here tonight. Now, when you think conservative pundit writing a Christmas novel, I'm sure that you think a lot of overbearing, religious cliches, very preachy, hackneyed, sappy Christmas tropes laid on really thick, and there's a lot of that in there. But because this tale crawled its way out of the gnarled, windswept cavern that is the inside of Glenn Beck. It's like the most fucked up story about Christmas I've ever heard. That's why I wanted to tell it to you guys tonight. And so now, without further ado, I'd like to present my telling of Glenn Beck's The Christmas Sweater. Our story begins in a small town in rural Washington. The protagonist of the novel is an 8 or 9 year old boy. In the book, he's not named Glenn, but we're gonna call him Glenn right now. Just to make everyone's life a whole lot easier. So young Glenn lives in a small town in rural Washington with his mother. And things have been very difficult for Glenn and his mother for the past 3 years, because 3 years ago, Glenn's father died of cancer. And Glenn's mother was not making enough money to support an entire family. She's had to take on extra work. They've been barely making ends meet. Their lives have been very difficult for 3 years, and for Glenn, this drastic change in the circumstances of his life is best exemplified by a sharp drop in the quality of Christmas presents over the last 3 years. That's what really resonates with him. Ever since his dad died, Christmas has been super shitty. He always gets cheap presents, he gets socks, puzzles, he gets boule-ass action figures. He'll get like a dude who transforms into a car, but it's not called a transformer, it's called a changeling or something. That's not what Glenn wants. Glenn wants a bicycle. He wants a shiny, new, red bike. His mother hasn't had enough money to get it for him any of the last 3 years, but Glenn knows that this year is going to be different. He's been really mature, he's been a really good boy all year. He's been very vocal about wanting a bike. He feels his mother's been dropping hints, maybe sneaking around. And Glenn has faith. Not just in his mother, but in God. And here's where God starts to poke his nose into the affair. Glenn knows that God does everything for a reason. So God's not just going to kill his dad and be a dick about things. Clearly, God is working in mysterious ways, you know? Glenn's father had to be taken from him so that through their suffering, eventually Glenn and his
mother could be raised to even greater heights of prosperity and happiness. Things will get better. It has to get better. You know, Glenn believes he's been praying. He really cares, and he knows that this year, God and his mother will get him a bike. So Glenn wakes up really excited on Christmas morning, and he runs downstairs into the living room, and none of the things under the tree is shaped like a bike. They're more square, rectangular shapes, clearly none of them have wheels. It doesn't bode well, and sure enough, when he opens the gifts, it's more socks. He gets another puzzle, San Francisco. He gets another blue-like action figure. This is clearly Batman, but it's called Nightman. Glenn is so disappointed, and then his mother goes, "Wait, Glenn, I've got one more special gift for you," and Glenn's heart leaps, and she pulls out another rectangle, and his heart sinks. And he goes, "Oh, let me see what's inside this rectangle." And he opens it up, and inside is a sweater. An itchy, clearly homemade, loudly colored, uncomfortable, not a bike Christmas sweater. And Glenn is so distraught, and his mother goes, "Why don't you try it on?" And he tries it on, and it doesn't quite fit right. And she goes, "What do you think of it?" And he goes, "It's fine. Would you please excuse me?" He runs up to his room, and he pulls the sweater off, throws it in a crumpled heap in the corner, flings himself on his bed, and starts sobbing. He's just so sad, he's so let down, he's so disappointed, because for the past 3 years, he's wanted this bike, and it's been the thing that he's looked towards to make him be a good boy, to make him have faith, to make him try to be mature. He's known that he was going to get this thing that he deserved. He relied on his mother and God, and they let him down. And now he's just a kid who doesn't have a dad, and doesn't have a bike, and he has a sweater, and he's looking out the window, and the kid across the street from him got a bike. So he's riding a bike around in front, and Glenn is so sad. His mother, who realizes that something is wrong, she comes in to console him. "Glenn, honey." And she sees the sweater lying in a crumpled ball on the floor. And her heart breaks. She very slowly, stoically walks over to the sweater, picks it up, she folds it up, puts it on the counter. She says, "Honey, please don't treat your new sweater like that." She walks out of the room. And then there's this really intense passage. Sits there and actually thinks about how it must have felt for his mother, knitting the sweater, knowing that he wasn't. And he pictures his mother going to a yarn store and picking out yarn and agonizing over which color of yarn to pick, trying to pick her son's best colors, trying to pick the colors that look best together. And all the while she knows it doesn't matter what color the sweater is. It's not a bike, it's a sweater. And her son's not going to want it. And every day she has to walk home from work past the thing that her son actually wants in a store window that she can't afford. She's got to go home and wait until her son falls asleep and sneak out into the living room to knit this futile sweater out of misery. Trying to remember how long her son's arms are. Trying to make it fit as well as possible. And all the while she knows it doesn't matter how well it fits. It's not a bike, it's a sweater. And her son's going to be disappointed and feel let down and unhappy, but she still has to try to make it as well as she can. And for just a split second, Glenn feels extremely guilty. And then his mother comes in and she goes, "Put your sweater on, we're going to your grandparents." And I was like, "Fuck this!" Immediately, he does a complete 180. He's super pissed again. We drive out like 2 hours to the grandparents' farm. And all night, Glenn refuses to be a big boy. He's super not a big boy. He's a pill all night. Play the pill. He answers you monosyllabically. "How's your Christmas?" "It's fine." "Do you like your sweater?" "Yeah, it's fine." Makes everyone else have a worse time because he's having a bad time. Then at the end of the night, the mother says, "Glenn, I'm really tired. What say you and I spend the night here? We'll wake up in the morning, we'll have breakfast, we'll drive home. It'll be great." Glenn is also tired, but he's angry at his mother. And he wants to make shit difficult for her. So he goes, "Actually, I want to go home. I would like to sleep in my own bed tonight. It means a lot to me. Really, I'm tired. It's a very long drive. We have beds here we can sleep in." Glenn goes, "No, we're home Christmas Eve. I'd like to go home Christmas Day." Glenn's grandfather is standing there. He sees what Glenn is doing,
and he decides to teach Glenn a lesson, so he sides with him. He goes, yeah, you guys should drive home. Go on, honey, drive Glenn home. We'll see you some other time. Have a good night. Because Glenn's grandfather knows that as soon as they get into the car, Glenn's going to get chewed out, and that's exactly what happens. They get into the car, and Glenn's mother says, I can't believe you could be so selfish. I can't believe you could have been so immature. Things have been over all of us, etc., etc. You really let me down. I'm really disappointed in you. She feels bad. He feels bad. Everyone feels bad. They set off driving, and Glenn is in the back seat. He feels all bad about himself. He nods off, and then Glenn's mother, who is driving, is also very tired, also nods off, and gets into a fatal car wreck! Nothing more in his life anymore. He's 9 years old and his life is over before it started. And he feels so angry at this world and at this God that has let him down that he decides to take revenge on everything by making himself as unpleasant as possible. He's just a really difficult person to be around. That's how you rebel when you're a 9 year old. He's disruptive in class, he's not nice to his peers. Purposefully exhibits sins, jealousy, gluttony, things like that. He thinks sinful thoughts in church. He talks back to his grandparents. He tries to make himself the embodiment of awful things. He retreats into himself. He spends an increasing amount of time alone, out in the fields near his grandparents' farm, brooding. And it is while he is out in these fields brooding that he meets this creepy old man. Old man, the character is written really ambiguously. This old dude is either an angel or a pedophile. There's no it is one or the other because he only shows up when Glenn is completely alone. How was school today? You know, you shouldn't blame yourself for your mother's death. School was great. At this point in time, Glenn's only friend his own age is this rich kid. His name is Terrence. I think his name is Terrence. I remember his name being Terrence. Even if it wasn't, his name is Terrence. And this rich kid, he's got everything that he wants. He's got everything that he wants. His parents throw money at him and give him whatever he asks for, but he's not really happy because they don't really love him. This child is a walking moral, and the moral is completely lost upon Glenn. Glenn thinks that because this kid has everything he wants, he must be happy. Glenn completely externalizes the idea of happiness and attaches it to things. And he sees this kid who has all these things, who has two parents, and all the belongings that he wants, and he sees himself with comparatively very few things. And he decides that because he doesn't have these things, he could never achieve anything, he could never move forward, he could never be happy at all. And he becomes filled with contempt for his grandparents' modest way of living. So now he's walking around his grandparents' house like shitting on the wallpaper. Talking about how the furniture needs to be reupholstered. He's like a snob in his own house. And the next thing that happens is things come to a head. He refuses to eat something his grandmother makes. His grandmother makes him oatmeal and he calls it poor person food or something. They would never eat this in Terrence's house. And she is so distraught, she cries, and the grandfather, this is the last straw for him. He is enraged. You cannot attack people who have taken you in like this. It's almost Christmas time again. I'm not gonna have little Glenn shit on a second Christmas. And so Glenn and the grandfather have what I can only describe as a battle of wills. It's really weird because in the text it's clear that you're supposed to be on the grandfather's side. But the way that he goes about it, he like locks Glenn in a room with him and he goes, "All right, now I'm going to yell at you until you think the way I think you should think." So the scene is just Glenn in a chair and his grandfather's going, "God loves you. Everybody loves you. We're all here." Glenn's going, "No, nobody loves me. God has turned his back on me. God's taken everything from me. There's nothing for me in this world. My life is over." And the grandfather goes, "No, you have to try. Happiness comes from within and God." And Glenn goes, "I don't have anything. God's taken my parents. God's taken everything from me. I don't have a dad. I don't have a bike. I don't have a car. It doesn't matter about the things that matters about. Everyone cares about you. You have a life here. We're trying to move forward. You have to pick yourself up and go on." And Glenn goes, "I tried to do that. I tried for 3 years. I prayed and I was good. And I just wanted a bike. All I wanted was one thing. And I put my entire being into it. God and my parents, everyone I've ever relied on, they couldn't even get me this one simple thing." And Glenn's grandfather goes, "Shut up, Jesus Christ. Oh my God, shut up. Oh my God. Come with me. And he takes Glenn with him down into the garage. They get down into the garage there. And there's a tarp with something under it. Pulls the tarp off and it's a bike. It's a shiny new red bike. And he goes, "Look, there it is. There's the bike. We got it for you last year. We were going to give it to you the day after Christmas when you woke up at our house, but you were being such a little dick about your sweater. I'm going to make things difficult for your mom. Then I decided to teach you a lesson. And now your mom is dead. And we were going to give you a sweater right after your mom died. It didn't make any sense. So we waited, but you've been such a little asshole since then. You've been such a negative personality. You don't even deserve this bike anymore, but it's been here waiting for you to deserve it for nigh on 1 year. You always had a bike.
Exploding around him.
in constantly. Devin can only see bright things, and he's running, and he's cold, and he falls to the ground. Gets up, and he's covered in mud. He can't see anything, and he realizes that he's alone. That he wasn't alone before. He thought he was, but he wasn't. He had his grandparents. He had an entire structure at school and church. He had God. Now he's alone. And Glenn thinks back to every time that he's felt attacked and he felt the world has let down over the last year. He realizes that it was about him not trusting. That it was about him not trying. He realizes that he's dug himself into this pit of negativity for an entire year. But really, it's been him who's not letting himself be happy. And Glenn realizes that he doesn't hate God. He doesn't hate the world. He hates himself. And at this point in the story, Glenn is standing there in the rain, ostensibly waiting to die. A really intense thing for a 10-year-old. When suddenly he feels a strong confidence. He looks up his whole green. What are you doing here, man? He goes, hey son, it looks like you're in quite a predicament. What's going on? I turned my back on everyone, I ran away, I threw my life away, I beat God shittily. And the old creepy dude goes, it's alright, you gotta believe. And Glenn goes, I don't even know if I can believe anymore. This is so terrible. I turned my back on everyone. How would you even trust me? And Glenn's the old man goes, you just gotta have faith. And in the story, in the book, he's not singing. He's fucking singing. So he's like, I don't know, I gotta have faith. That's why I'm gonna take a call from me. I've been a sinner this whole year, just trying as hard as I can to be awful. And the old guy goes, you just gotta take my hand and have faith in my ITA. And he's like, I don't know if I can take your hand. And he goes, just take my hand. And I'm like, I don't know if I can just take my hand. And they shake each other's hands and they walk through the storm. That's the way they walk. Through the storm! They emerge on the other side of the storm in this technicolor dream world. The sky is green and the grass is red. Ducks have four legs and no wings. And Glenn turns to the old man, who by now is definitely an angel. He's the world's most elaborately theatrical. And Glenn turns to the old guy and he goes, is this heaven? And the old guy goes, no, heaven is much better. And then Glenn passes out. And then Glenn wakes up in his bed in his home and it's Christmas morning of the previous year and it was all a dream!
Died during the whole Christmas sweater thing. And
apparently, the dream sequence, the storm sequence, is based on an actual dream that Glenn had when he was in his 30s. And it was that dream that prompted Glenn, that affected him so thoroughly that he decided to stop drinking and drugging and get his shit together. Maybe even convert to Mormonism, I'm not sure. But in any case, think about that. We're going to sleep tonight. Thank you guys so much for coming.